Two Chairs No Wedding, episode number 485, The Haunted House. Two Chairs No Wedding is brought to you by folks over at weaversdepartmentstore.com. Head over to Weavers and check out, since we're talking about the haunted house, the old man Remshaw print. Oh, it's spooky. His eyes fall everywhere. Also, you might want to get, since you like a haunted house, perhaps, check out this five classics Don Knotts comedy collection. You can get The Ghost and Mr. Chicken and four other great Don Knotts movies on DVD. You'll love it. And since you're talking about Barney, let's get a Body by Barney t-shirt. Head over to weaversdepartmentstore.com and check it out. Hey, Two Chairs is also brought to you by our executive producer, Randall Moffitt. Thank you. I'm Alan Newsom, your host for Two Chairs No Waiting. And it's always great to spend a little time in Mayberry and talk about just the show we love. We've loved this show forever. And unusually, we're going to just run through an episode and talk a little bit about it and be followed up by a report from Randy Turner, who has a very interesting report about one of the characters that actually appear on this show. So I thought this would be a good opportunity for us to, tie in two little loves. Two loves that we both have, where we love the episode, The Haunted House. Now, all right, so let me set this up, make sure everybody remembers The Haunted House, okay? So in the plot of the episode is basically Opie, you know, hits his baseball and then has to go and get it, and then Barney and Gomer get scared. You remember all that? All right, so we'll run through it as we go. But it's a great episode. And so let's get started on this. I guess I need to play a little bit of music. I think a little bit of, Ellie's theme or something. Let's try that one. That's nice and relaxing. There we go. All right. So let's head over and check out what's going on there in Mayberry. So at the beginning of the episode, we see Opie and... Well, actually, it's not Arnold. Now, the character is played by Ronnie Dappo, but in this particular episode, he's never said to be Arnold. Doesn't say it isn't Arnold, but they never say his name one way or the other. Now, you'll remember previously when we saw Ronnie Dappo, he was Arnold, the little boy, the spoiled kid who wanted his bicycle. I want my bike. Well, he's the same kid we see in this episode, as they're walking there down the road and seeing, going over to play baseball and hit the ball, right? So that's Ronnie, the same young man. And they go over and they're playing baseball right there in front of the Remshaw House. Now, the Remshaw House, as you all will remember, or may not know, I should say, I guess, it sets the actual house on the set sets right beside Andy's house. Oh, you didn't know that? Well, it does. Let me show you this, or let me tell you about this. If you head over to retroweb.com/40acres, great website. You would definitely enjoy being there. But if you go there and you look at the residential street, you can see shots of the 40 acres back lot that include Andy Taylor's house and also what was, if you've watched Gone with the Wind, I don't know if any of you ever have, but it was Aunt Pittypat's house. Now, Aunt Pittypat's house in Gone with the Wind is the exact same house that on the Andy Griffith Show was the Remshaw place. That's right. And not only was it the Remshaw place, as I mentioned, it is right beside Andy's house. If you go toward Mayberry, if you guys remember the episodes and what they actually look like, and drive past Andy's house, you would see this same house, Aunt Pittypat's house. So, when the boys are playing ball out in front of the Remshaw place, they're actually right beside Andy's house, believe it or not. Isn't that amazing? I don't know if you knew that. So, anyway, let's get back to the show. So the Remshaw place was a deserted house. It was there up in the outskirts of town, even though it was really beside Andy's house. It was in the outskirts of town, and the boys are out there, and they decided they were going to play some ball. So they started playing ball right there on the streets. And Mickey Mantle, you know, you can't hit this curveball. He's telling Opie. Opie knocks off his shoes, gets ready to throw go. And, wow, he hits the ball right through the window of the old Remshaw place. And now the boys have to figure out what are they going to do. They got to go in here and get this thing. And, of course, being young men, young boys, or an old guy like me, as they're going up to the door, they're a little afraid because this old haunted house. And then they get close to the door, and they're talking to you about each the stuff that's in there, talking about Mr. Remshaw and everything, supposed to be a ghost. And they hear a ghost and run off. And they head over to the courthouse. And when they get to the courthouse, Otis is in jail over there, as you may or may not know. He's normally in jail if he's done anything. But Barney is trying to, before he'll release him, he wants him to do some jump rope. That's right, jump rope. Can you believe it? So he asked him to. So let's hear this.
Oh, I can't do that.
Well, then you have to jump. It's just that simple.
Jump rope.
Watch careful, Otis.
So Barney's going to do the jump rope for him. And he even has a rhyme that goes with it. Otis goes on to say, if I did that, Barney, everybody would really think I was drunk. So, anyway, Otis gets to leave eventually, even though, because he does the rhyme about slow it down and let me in, or I'll go out and buy some gin. You remember? So then, I'll call him Arnold. Opie's buddy and Opie come running into there and telling about what happened up at the Remshaw place. You know, they were in there and they heard a ghost and they heard something going, ooh.
They went, ooh.
Of course, Andy and Barney, they don't believe them. You know how that goes. They're young men and they're doing that, but they heard something after they hit the ball in there. He didn't mean to hit it in. But they heard this sound, and of course they're laughing at the boys and saying, well, y'all don't go back up there. Need to quit playing around the old Remshaw house. And of course Barney's going, of course, yeah, you shouldn't do that. And then just moments later, Andy says, hey, Barney, I got an idea. Why don't you run up to the Remshaw place and get that ball? And Barney's like, are you kidding? Are you kidding?
You mean you want me to go up to that haunted house?
You want me to go up to that haunted house? I'm not going to go up there. So Andy goes and gives him a little bit of jibes and stuff. And eventually, he finally has to go up there. And he doesn't want to go by himself. But Gomer comes in. And he goes, hey, Gom, you want to go for a ride with me? And Gomer says, sure. So they head up to the old Remshaw place, and when they get there, it's the first time Gomer finds out that Barney's wanting him to go in and get this ball. And he says, well, why don't you go in, Barney? Well, Barney says, well, I got to go and check the radiator or something. Something on the car, the timing on the car is running terrible. And Gomer's like, well, I'll do that. And Barney says, I thought of it first. anyway, I think it's funny. Then they head inside together, because since Gomer won't go without him, Barney has to go. And they head in there into the house to try to find the ball. But before they get in there, they too hear the sound and take off running. Barney comes running into the door of the courthouse, grabs the water. He just drinks down a whole bunch of water, never got the ball. He's panicked completely. And then Andy heads up with him. Because in the end, he's like, well, come on. You go back over and get Gomer. And you and me and Gomer are going to go up to the Remshaw house and get that baseball. Now, while this is going on, they're letting Otis out of jail. So he's hearing this whole conversation. But Otis is saying, I wouldn't go up there. So this is one of the best scenes to me. They get to the door of the old Remshaw place. They start to go in. And as they go in, Gomer and Barney are side by side with Andy, touching his shoulders. They're so close. Andy can't take a step without the boys stuck to him. And they are completely stuck to him. And they go, and when they get there, they bend over to pick up the baseball. And when Andy bends down to pick up that baseball, they all three bend over at the same time. I don't know who thought of that idea, but that is a funny scene because you can definitely see Gomer and Barney are scared in this house, even with Andy right with them. So they continue to move just shoulder to shoulder to shoulder. And Andy finally shrugs them off to get rid of them. Great scene, a great shot. So Andy goes off to look into the back room. And while he's off looking into the back room, you'll remember that Gomer, he falls, I don't know, through a wall or a door or something. But Barney don't know it. So he's standing there still looking around saying, well, Barney, I don't really see anything. Gomer? Gomer? And he reaches around, and of course, no Gomer. Gomer has disappeared. Barney completely panics, and eventually Andy comes back and sees that Barney is panicking and everything. Where is Gomer? And he says, I don't know. He disappeared. What did I tell you about this haunted house? I told you. And Andy's like, well, you know, it can't have been. He just stepped into some kind of closet or something. Well, then in just a few minutes, as they're standing there, they're looking one direction, both together, and Gomer just appears right behind them out of nowhere. And he says, I don't know. I must have stepped into a closet or something, which was exactly what Andy said. Now, off the story a little bit, I don't think I've ever heard that phrase before. Is that a phrase that you guys have ever heard? That I stepped into a closet. Oh, he must have stepped into a closet or something. And then he said, I don't know. I guess I stepped into a closet. So that was a phrase that's not common to me. So the fact that they both said it made it even more funny. Well, they end up searching around the house a little bit more, looking at stuff and seeing what's going on. Well, Andy just feels the fireplace and says it feels kind of warm. And so he was going to go look and see what it was. But then he goes off looking around and tells Gomer and Barney to look around, see what they can find. So they're talking about the hired man that got killed there and everything. And they look downstairs, and there's an axe on the back of the door that goes down into the basement. So neither one of them want to go down there. Barney's like, ain't no tramps down there? Closes the door. Nope, none down there. Because neither one of them want to go down there. So finally we get to the scene where they come around and the eyes on the picture of Mr. Remshaw is looking around, seeing each other, and they run out the door. Well, Andy doesn't run out, if you'll remember, but Barney and Goober did. Then we see the two folks come out got Otis and the moonshiner that has actually been doing all this stuff. He's in here with us, I guess causing trouble. He's the one that's actually been doing everything. So that's Big Jack, if you'll remember. He comes out and him and Otis come out there. And then they start looking around and they see the old Remshaw. Guys, this is some of the fun. It's just a great episode. They finally see Mr. Remshaw's eyes looking at them, and they too take off running because there's an axe floating around, the eyes are looking around, and a baseball rolls down the steps. What a great thing. Barney comes in and tries to save Andy, and Andy pulls the same trick on him as well. So then they end up going off to bust up the still and arrest Big Jack and Otis. And then we end the episode with the state police officer coming there to actually arrest Jack. And he goes in there to arrest him out of the jail cell. And Barney is skipping rope there in the cell. So there you go. That's all the stuff that actually happened on that episode. Now, as we talked about, the Remshaw House is this old, foreboding, decaying, two-story, Victorian, Italian-type structure there in Mayberry. And its exact location on the show is unknown. They don't ever tell you exactly where it is, but it the dialogue suggested it is somewhere on the outskirts of town. Now, I already told you the secret that it's really right beside Andy's house, and they just dressed it up. But still, you got to remember that the house was owned by the deceased local man who was simply known as Old Man Remshaw. And he was mostly a really private man. And he didn't want anyone near his property or his house. So that was the reason everybody thought it was haunted. And that was also probably the reason it was empty all these years, ever since he and Andy were kids. Now, Big Jack Anderson, he set up his still down there in the bottom and started moonshining. Now, I knew nothing about Big Jack at all until this week when I heard a great story from Randy Turner over at Today in Mayberry History, as I abruptly cut that off. So let's go over and hear from Randy Turner.
Welcome to This Week in Mayberry History, a report by special correspondent Randy Turner of the Gomer and Cooper Pyle Comic Book Literary Guild of the Mayberry Historical Society.
Nestor Paiva may not be a name you know, but the busy character actor appeared in literally hundreds of films and television series, including in a fan favorite episode of The Andy Griffith Show. Nestor was born on June the 30th, 1905, in Fresno, California. After high school, he eventually attended the University of California at Berkeley, where he was involved in collegiate theater. During his senior year, after the director of a planned production had to step away, Nestor directed the play himself before graduating in 1931. Trading on that experience, after graduation, Nestor directed a radio acting troupe called the 8 O'Clock Players for an Oakland, California radio station for several years. By the mid-1930s, he was acting in what proved to be a long-running Los Angeles production of a temperance play called The Drunkard. In 1937, he made his film debut in an uncredited role as the servant of the lead female character in the movie Island Captives, about a woman shipwrecked on a jungle island with a man who had murdered her father. This was the first of what would become a standby for Nestor. Of Portuguese descent, he had a vaguely ethnic appearance and was good with dialects, leading to him often playing various types of foreigners throughout his long career. Nestor immediately became a busy character actor, though often in small uncredited roles at first, while still appearing in the play The Drunkard. A typical role was as a Hawaiian henchman in The Green Hornet Strikes Again. Within a few years, while still sometimes playing uncredited roles, Nestor began to win bigger roles in films. By the mid-1940s, he finally had to leave the temperance play, in which he had appeared for 11 years. In 1947, Nestor began working in another field in which he became much in demand, that of old-time radio. He made his debut in a series called Escape. He appeared in an episode of that series in each of the following 2 years. Over his radio career, he made hundreds of radio appearances, finally ending his work in the field in 1956 in an episode of Gunsmoke, in which he appeared with Howard McNear and Parley Bearer. He had appeared in Dodge City on the radio 4 times previously. He made his television debut in 1952, and his roles continued to reflect his specialty of playing a variety of ethnic types. For example, he played roles from Sir Montague Bruce to an Asian named Lo Sing in the series China Smith, and often played Mexicans in Westerns such as The Lone Ranger. The role for which he is best known was as the boat captain, Lucas, in the 1954 classic, The Creature from the Black Lagoon. He reprised the character the following year in Revenge of the Creature. In 1963, Nestor appeared in Mayberry as the moonshiner, Big Jack Anderson, who was using the old Remshaw House as a base for his moonshining operation, relying on its reputation as a haunted house to keep people away. The next year, Nestor voiced several characters in the fondly remembered primetime animated series, Johnny Quest. He continued to appear in series such as McHale's Navy, The Beverly Hillbillies, Get Smart, and the TV version of Gunsmoke, before his final guest role in a TV series, Family Affair. He then filmed roles in two more feature films and a TV movie, though they all were released after Nestor passed away from cancer in 1966. Well, that's it for this week. Thanks for listening. And remember to take Andy's advice and go out there and act like somebody.
Wow. Thank you, Randy. Thank you for that great report. I knew nothing about Nestor. This is a great report. And it's really what got me to do this episode tonight. Folks, if you'd like to make sure you don't miss any of Randy's great stuff that he puts out, send him an email at turnersgrade@gmail.com, and he will help you make sure you don't miss anything that he has to publish. So great job, Randy. That was a really great report. I'd never even looked into that fellow before, so it was a great, it was a lot of fun. Johnny Quest, I didn't realize he was in that at all, and how great that he worked on Gunsmoke with Parley and Floyd, Howard McNear. And of course, he was in The Creature with Black Lagoon, if I could talk, with Julie, Nurse Mary, Julie Andrew, I went blank on her name, but she was in that movie. She was the star of The Creature of the Black Lagoon. Remember, she was in that. She was Nurse Mary on the Andy Griffith Show as well. So he's within that with her. All right, guys, I am going to have to get out of here, I believe. Julie Adams, thank you, the chat room. Susan told me, thank you. Julie Adams, I went completely blank. I guess I've been a little bit distracted tonight. You guys may have seen this, but we will be doing an episode in the coming weeks here about Dean Webb. Now, Dean Webb was the the mandolin playing darling boy that you guys all know and love as well as I do. Well, we found out that he passed away over this past weekend. And don't have a whole lot of details about it at this point, but Dean is certainly missed. He was a scholar and a gentleman. He was really an amazing man, always super nice to me. I just can't say enough about him. There will be a special newsletter of the e-bullet that'll be coming out really soon. Jim Clark has announced, and we'll have Dean featured in that, but he passed away on Saturday, June 30th. I was at an event this weekend over in Calhoun, Georgia, and we were there with Maggie Peterson and Ronnie Schell. So Maggie, of course, was Charlene Darlin, and Ronnie Schell was, he was Duke on Gomer Pyle Show. He was on a couple of episodes of the Andy Griffith Show as well. But Maggie was distraught when she found out about Dean, and it's always sad when we lose one of the Mayberry folks. And Dean was a really great guy. I've met him several times myself, and he was always so nice. And anyway, he will be missed, and we will do a cover about him. We'll do an episode about him as soon, but I was a little bit distracted today thinking about that. So hopefully the show was fun and you enjoyed it, because it was a good, I love the episode, The Haunted House, and just thinking about those different scenes just brings a smile to my face. Watching my favorite again is when Barney and Gomer come walking in with Andy, shoulders to shoulder, tight against him. And then even when they get over to pick up the ball, they all lean down at the same time. What a great time that is. So, folks, hey, I want you to have a great Mayberry week. And let's be thankful for our friends like Dean Webb that have brought us so much smiles and laughter and just fun over the years on the Andy Griffith Show. It's a real blessing to have just been able to watch this show and enjoy ourselves because of all the hard work that these people have done in the years past and, continue to do. So I think that's all I have for you. I would love to hear from you. If you'll give me a call at 888-684-8415, it would be great for you to give me a call if you'd like to. You can also email me at floyd@imaberry.com. I'd love to hear from you. Just head over to twochairsnowaiting.com and click the contact button. That's got all the information. You don't have to remember all that stuff I just told you. Go over there, click the contact button. You can, it'll have my email, the phone number, and everything. I love hearing from you guys. Thanks so much for being here with me. And let's just go and watch some episodes of The Darlings this week and The Haunted House and just have some fun. Until next time, everybody, we'll see you right here on Two Chairs.